Good evening. Namaskar. This is Dr. Manisha Singh, Senior Consultant Gynaecologist and Subspecialist in Reproductive Medicine and Surgery, talking to you from Fortis, Bangalore, about very common issues related to fertility. And that is pertaining to intrauterine insemination as well as IVF. Now, why did I choose this topic? It is because when I see patients in my clinic, they seem to use these terms interchangeably. They are not very clear as to what is IUI, what is IVF. And I thought this is the time to clarify people's doubts, especially for those who are seeking assistance. And let's be clear here that today, 1 in 10 couples needs help to conceive their baby. So thankfully, this broadcast is going to be there on YouTube for those of you who missed the live relay, and for those that wish to refer to some of the concepts pertaining to ART in the future. So let's get started with the slideshow and let's see if I can simplify things for those seeking assistance when it comes to fertility options. Please bear with us. So I hope people can now start seeing the presentation. So I work at Fortis Bangalore and my department is creation. We are the Center for Infertility, Assisted Reproduction and Minimal Access, Gynae Surgery. We are also the Center of Excellence for Endometriosis Care. So today we are going to unravel the distinctions between intrauterine insemination and IVF. So everyone knows that through a menstrual cycle, at the time of ovulation, one egg is released, and this egg, if fortunate enough to be fertilized by the sperm, forms an embryo, and this embryo formation happens in the fallopian tube. And if this embryo is lucky enough to get implanted in the womb, we have a pregnancy. Now, for a pregnancy to implant, it's a very complex interplay of hormones, as well as the perfect anatomical and physiological setting for the two entities, the egg and the sperm, to meet to form an embryo in the fallopian tube here, and then have a journey down and implant in the womb. But as I said, it's an extremely complex interplay, and this presentation does not allow me to go into the lengths and breadths of it, but I will try to answer questions as we go along. Now, if I was to go back to the history of assisted reproductive techniques, I would have to mention that techniques like IUI and IVF have been mentioned in the Mahabharata. Now, if Oppenheimer and Einstein could relate to the Bhagavad Gita and take inspiration from the Bhagavad Gita for all their inventions, including the atomic bomb, then the events surrounding the Bhagavad Gita are that of Mahabharata. And if you look at the conception of the Pandavas, it is very clear that all the different devas gave birth to each of the Pandavas, and that was through possibly intrauterine insemination and what we call the intrauterine insemination with the help of donor sperm. If you look at the English history of it, we find reference to Henry IV in the 1400s. He was also called the important king of Castile. And it is believed that he used artificial insemination to impregnate his Portuguese wife, Joanna. In the 1700s, Spallanzani used sperm to inseminate his pet dog, and she gave birth to three puppies. So animal husbandry has quite liberally used artificial insemination to have the finest breed of cattle and farm animals. As far as humans go, the first documented artificial insemination, and AI doesn't stand for artificial intelligence, it's artificial insemination, was used in London by John Hunter for a patient who was found to have hypospadias. If you look at IVF, once again, going back to Mahabharata, there is no way Gandhari could have had 100 kids unless they resorted to something like IVF. And she must have been obviously hyperstimulated. But the first known human baby born through IVF is Louise Brown, and she was born on the 25th of July, 1978. She was conceived at Bone Hall Clinic in Cambridge under the able guidance of Bob Edwards and Patrick Steptoe. I must say, I have been extremely privileged to have worked at Bone Hall in Cambridge through my subspecialty training. In India as well, a couple of months after Louise Brown was born, we had our first Indian IVF baby called Durga, and the credit for the same goes to Professor Subhash Mukhopadhyay from Calcutta. Unfortunately, he has been one of our unsung heroes and did not get the due credit that he should have got for his work in the field of reproductive medicine, physiology, and endocrinology. We have come a long way since 1978. So let's talk about IUI, the simplest of techniques. When all the primary investigations are completed and one ascertains that a person has a problem in conceiving naturally. So intrauterine insemination literally means inseminating the sperm of a husband or a donor into the womb of the woman directly. Of course, this sperm has to be prepped, has to be capacitated, and the good and the bad sperm have to be separated out, and only the concentrate of the good sperm is inseminated into the uterus. Now, the clear indications for IUI are unexplained infertility and male factor infertility. But in a cosmopolitan city like Bangalore, most couples coming to me come for IUI directly, and they know IUI. They know all about IUI, and they want IUI because they do not have the time for sex. They want a rapid fire pregnancy somewhere in between their very busy work life. What are the prerequisites if one has to do an IUI? It is important that the female has her fallopian tube patency checked. At least one fallopian tube needs to be patent or open for the sperm and the egg to meet when this treatment is done. Women may have an IUI treatment through their own natural cycle, or they may be stimulated, which is their ovaries may be stimulated with the help of hormone tablets or hormone injections. Generally, we use the husband's sperm, but as I said, there may be guys who do not have sperm and we may need to resort to donor sperm. And this can also be used, and the insemination is generally done once we trigger ovulation in the mid-cycle when the egg is mature enough to go about the fertilization process. Now you may ask me, what is the success rate for IUI? It's generally 15 to 20% per treatment cycle. And most couples resort to going through three cycles of IUI. And if I started 100 couples on IUI treatment, at the end of three treatment cycles, roughly around 40 to 45% of these couples would have achieved a pregnancy. Now, if they have failed to achieve success through three cycles of IUI, one may go up to a maximum of six cycles. But then what? Well, one can proceed down the route of IVF if your circumstances permit. Of course, there are financial implications to IVF which are bigger than those for the IUI treatment. And IVF more certainly has a slightly higher success rate as well. So what is IVF? So IVF is totally a different entity to IUI. In IUI, the fertilization happens inside a woman's body. So it's almost like getting pregnant naturally, except that the sperm has been put in artificially. But in IVF, the fertilization of the egg and the sperm happen outside the body in a petri dish. Today in India, IVF is a licensed treatment under the ART law 2022. And each treatment cycle spans between 4 to 6 weeks. Now, why might someone need IVF or ICSI, intracytoplasmic sperm injection? You may need in vitro fertilization if the lady has problems related to ovulation, if she has fallopian tubes that are blocked, and Louise Brown was a baby born because her mom had tubal factor subfertility. The lady may have endometriosis and her ovaries are slowly getting destroyed by the endometriosis process. Older women, and we see a lot of them today, because today women have a career and a life to sort out before they embark on the fertility journey. There may be those couples where all the investigation parameters are completely normal, but somewhere pregnancy does not seem to be happening. And about 10% of the infertile couple come under the unexplained infertility category. Those that have male factor issues such as low sperm number, poor sperm motility, abnormal looking sperm, they also need assisted conception in the form of IVF or ICSI. Now, there is a difference between IVF and ICSI in that in vitro fertilization, we put in about 100,000 capacitated sperm around each egg or oocyte in a petri dish to bring about a natural chance of the sperm fertilizing the egg. Whereas in ICSI, a single sperm is directly injected into the egg or the oocyte to bring about the fertilization process. Now, there are various treatment protocols that are adopted. What is important for patients to know is that each protocol is tailor-made to the individual requirements. So one size does not fit all. So kindly do not compare your treatment to someone else's treatment, because you have no idea what their comorbidities are and what their circumstances were in terms of their hormones and various other parameters. The stimulation phase of IVF, where we inject hormones into the woman, lasts for between 10 to 12 days. Now, the dose of the hormones is calculated based on the lady's egg reserve, her age, her body mass index, and a few other parameters. These injections are done at a fixed time in the evening, and they may be either just under your skin, subcutaneous, or they may be intramuscular. Of course, there will be a sense of heaviness in the tummy as the eggs start growing in response to these hormone injections. And if you feel uncomfortable, it's perfectly normal to have a simple analgesic like a paracetamol. It is important that should you have any untoward symptoms, it is important to discuss this with your doctor at the fertility unit. Scanning is a very important aspect of IVF, and pre-treatment scans are done within 3 months of initiating an IVF cycle to rule out things like polyps. Endometrial polyps can hamper with implantation of the embryo, and they need to be removed before the start of the treatment. If there are fibroids impinging into the cavity of the uterus, they need to be shaved off. If there are very large endometriotic cysts or other cysts in the ovary that may hamper with the stimulation and the egg collection, they need to be removed before initiating a cycle. But again, all of this is tailor-made to an individual. Not all cysts need surgery, not all fibroids need surgery. Therefore, there is no generalization. Through an IVF cycle, a woman will need between 3 to 4 scans. And these, alongside the hormonal tests, will help ascertain if she's on the right track and whether the dosing of the hormone is correct. Now, all the blood tests during the treatment cycle are done in the morning so that we have the reports by midday to plan the drugs for the evening. After 10 to 12 days of injection, the ovulation is triggered with the help of the HCG hormone injection, and this is typically a late night injection. Exactly 34 to 36 hours after this injection, we go around collecting the eggs. Now, what is important is that this is the last and final injection, so there are no injections beyond this trigger injection. And the timing for this injection is deadpan precise. If you've missed the timing, then you must contact the fertility unit the next morning if you are self-injecting this. If you are going to the hospital for this injection, then there is no case for you to miss this time slot. The egg collection procedure, generally performed 34 to 36 hours after the HCG, is a quick 20 to 30 minute procedure, generally done under a short anesthetic. And it is done through the vaginal route as is seen in the image. So the ultrasound probe goes into the vagina and the needle is attached here, and the needle sucks out the eggs from the follicles as they appear on the scan, and the eggs are collected in this test tube. On the same day, the partner or the husband comes in to give sperm, and this sperm is washed, prepped, capacitated, and kept ready for either insemination or injection. What happens in the lab, and this is what a lab looks like, and the eggs are collected and they're passed on to the embryologist. The embryologist then prepares the egg and the sperm for the fertilization process that typically happens in the afternoon after you've had your eggs collected in the morning. The eggs are graded as mature, immature, or postmature, or in medical jargon as M1, M2, or GVs. And only the mature eggs are suitable for injection. Immature eggs cannot be injected with the sperm, and they may have to be cultured a little bit more to see if they attain maturity for injection. As I said earlier, if the sperm parameters are normal, the couples can have IVF, where the sperm, about 100,000 of them, are just put in the dish alongside the egg to bring about fertilization. So this is what the dish looks like, and you have an egg in each of them in an oil drop, and the sperm is placed over it. The dish is placed in the incubator overnight to aid fertilization, and the next morning we can see how many of the eggs have fertilized. If all goes well, say I had 10 eggs collected, I would expect at least 7 or 8 of these eggs to have fertilized by the morning. As I said, ICSI is performed if there are sperm abnormalities, and there are many more advanced techniques now to pick and choose the right sperm to inject into every mature eggs. Just like IVF, the injected eggs are placed in the incubator overnight, and we get to know the fertilization the next morning, typically about 17, 18 hours later. Now, this is what the embryo looks like on the first day. You can see there are 2 nuclei inside, one from the egg and one from the sperm. and this is called a pronuclear embryo or the zygote. And the laboratory generally lets you know, once they see this, how many of your embryos have been formed. On the second day, the single cell has now divided, and we would see anywhere between 2 to 6, 7 cells on day 2. The embryo grading is a very visual impression. And what we do is we look at the cell margins, whether they are intact or they are fragmented, whether they are the right cell numbers as we expect on that particular day post-fertilization. And this helps us select the best embryos for transfer. Now, today we can culture the embryos till day 5, day 6. And this is what a day 5 embryo looks like. This is called the blastocyst. The outer cell lining is the trophectoderm, and then the inner cell mass is actually what forms the baby. And you would have the placenta forming from these cells. Now, not all embryos reach day 5 or reach the blastocyst stage. But if an embryo does reach a blastocyst stage, we can assume that this is a good quality embryo. But then again, there is grading for the blastocyst, and there are some blastocysts that will not make it into a baby. Now, it is important when you are offered a chance for embryo transfer that you have a clear understanding that not all embryos can become blastocysts. So if you sign up to have only a blastocyst embryo transfer, it is likely that you may not even have an embryo transfer, because all of the embryos may perish and not reach the blastocyst stage. So you could have a day 2 or a day 3 embryo transferred as well. Now, what are some of the criteria that we use when we consider transferring embryos? Now, if you are 36 or younger, you could have a single embryo transfer. So if you have 2 top quality embryos on day 3, or you have a top-notch blastocyst on day 5, you could consider having a single embryo transferred, and the other embryos could be frozen for you. Why do we say this? Because your chance of a multiple pregnancy is certainly higher with a replacement of more than one embryo. You could ask for a single embryo transfer if there are medical reasons for you not to have a twin pregnancy. Say you are a hypertensive, you should not have a twin pregnancy. We transfer 2 embryos generally if the embryo quality is mixed, or if there are no good quality embryos that we could freeze for you to use at a later date. Please note that only surplus good quality embryos will be frozen or vitrified, because the test of the embryo is not in the freezing, but when they are defrosted or when they are thawed. Not all embryos survive the thawing process, and only 75% of them may do so. Now, if you are older, if you are 37 years or older, you could have a 2 embryo transfer, unless you personally choose to have only a single embryo transfer. Now, as I said, our aim is to select the best embryos for transfer to maximize your chances of pregnancy, but to minimize your risk of a multiple pregnancy that comes with its own set of complications. Patients must agree to be available for embryo transfer anytime from day 2. So you can't have other commitments and say, oh, I can't come here, I can't come on that day, that time. You have to be flexible. If there are 1 or 2 embryos, we generally do an early transfer because of the worry that there may not be any transfers for you possible, because the embryos may perish. Around 2/3 of the patients may have a day 3 transfer if you are planning to transfer in the fresh IVF cycle. As I said earlier, blastocyst culture is wonderful, but it is not suitable for all couples. And especially in the elderly women, we find that the embryos may not last until the blastocyst stage. The embryo transfer procedure is actually a very quick procedure. It hardly takes 10 minutes. It involves the woman being taken to the theater, and under ultrasound guidance, a fine catheter loaded with the embryos is passed into the uterus, and the embryos are placed in the middle of the cavity. Now, this does not require an anesthetic. A woman need not be fasting, and there is no hospital admission. You could leave for home within 30 to 45 minutes after the embryo transfer. But it is important that you follow all the instructions that have been given to you by the fertility unit post-embryo transfer. As I mentioned earlier, surplus good quality embryos will be vitrified or frozen for use at a later date. It is important that you check the cost associated with embryo freezing, because it most certainly attracts extra costs either on a 6-monthly or annual basis. Post the embryo transfer, we advise patients to insert hormonal pessaries, the progesterone hormonal pessaries, because they provide additional hormonal or luteal phase support to the implanting embryo. The side effects of these pessaries are vaginal discharge or bloating. There may be some centers that may offer you progesterone hormone injections, but this treatment protocol varies from center to center, so it is best to clarify with your concerned doctor. A pregnancy test, either urinary pregnancy test or a beta HCG, is performed 2 weeks after the embryo transfer. And if the test is positive, you will be advised to come for an ultrasound scan 2 weeks later. If you have moved away from where you had your fertility treatment, it is imperative that you inform the fertility unit of the outcome of the treatment cycle. Now you will ask me, what is the chance of me having a baby after IVF or ICSI, given the fact that IUI has a success rate of about 15 to 20%. I would say that with IVF, ICSI, your chance of pregnancy is around 35 to 40%. But how many of these couples will take home a baby after every treatment cycle? Roughly around 25 to 30%. Because you have to account for miscarriages, ectopic pregnancies, and what have you. The likelihood of successful outcomes reduces with advancing maternal age. And for those that are 40 plus, the realistic chance of you taking home a baby after the age of 40 is between 5 and 10%, even with IVF treatment. As I said, IVF and other forms of ART can result in multiple pregnancy. So we have seen a single embryo transfer leading to a twin pregnancy. And two embryos can result in triplets. So what is the chance of having a twin pregnancy when I transfer two embryos? Well, the realistic chance of twins is 15%. The problem with multiple pregnancy is that it's all well and good that you get two for the price of one, but the risk of miscarriage multiplies about 2 or 3 times. The risk of premature babies and the need for neonatal intensive care admission, obstetric complication, and obstetric deliveries all increases. The side effects associated with IVF treatment are many. You may either respond excessively or you may have a suboptimal response to stimulation. There may be a need to recalculate your dose of the hormones during the stimulation phase. You may end up getting hyperstimulation, and that is called OHSS. If someone is diagnosed to have ovarian hyperstimulation, we will need to freeze all the embryos and you will not have a frozen embryo. You will have a frozen embryo transfer. You will not have a fresh embryo transfer. Cycle cancellation may also happen if there is OHSS or there is a suboptimal response to stimulation. It is possible that during egg collection, we may find no eggs whatsoever despite the presence of follicles. And as I said, even if embryos are formed, the embryos may all perish and there may be no embryos available for transfer. There is a risk of congenital abnormalities in the babies following assisted conception, and that is slightly higher than the normal population. In the normal population, the risk of congenital abnormality is between 3 to 4%, and in IVF conceptions, it is about 5 to 6%. But today in the world, we have an excess of 9 million babies born through assisted conception. There will also be anesthetic complications. And of course, during egg collection, there is always a surgical risk of bleeding, injury to the pelvic organs, infection, especially if you have endometriotic cysts in the ovaries. There is a chance that the needle may go through the endometrioma and that may cause infection later on. And most of these procedures are therefore covered by a shot of antibiotic. Let's talk a little bit about ovarian hyperstimulation. About 10% of women may be diagnosed with ovarian hyperstimulation, typically if they are very young women who are less than 30 years of age. They are very thin with a low BMI. They have polycystic ovary syndrome, excess use of hormonal injections, very high levels of estrogen during stimulation, and previous history of ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome. Now, mild, moderate, or severe, and typically we find women having nausea, vomiting, abdominal swelling, breathing difficulties, wanting to pass urine but can't pass urine, and reduce urine output. As I mentioned earlier, if we diagnose somebody with OHSS, we can collect the eggs, freeze all the embryos, and they can be transferred at a later date, because a fresh embryo transfer resulting in a pregnancy always makes the OHSS worse. And some women may need to be admitted in the intensive care unit. Now, what is the general advice for those seeking fertility treatment? And this is not just related to IVF, but for any form of fertility treatment. To have a healthy baby, the mother needs to be healthy. The microenvironment inside the mother needs to be healthy. Therefore, it is pertinent and important that a woman maintains a very healthy diet. She needs to hydrate well, have at least 2.5 to 3 liters of water, because water is the elixir of life. 45 minutes to 60 minutes of sweat-inducing exercise is also good. Not because it will help you lose weight, but it just makes your metabolic processes optimum within the body. Avoid excessive weight gain, stop smoking, and definitely avoid alcohol. It is important to use folic acid regularly because it prevents against neural tube defects in the baby. Make sure that you are up to date with your pap smear test. And before you embark on the fertility treatment journey, make sure that your immunity for syphilis, hepatitis B, hepatitis C, HIV, rubella, and chickenpox has been tested. And finally, it is important that you do not book holidays, trips, functions, celebrations, and parties during this treatment period, because you need to be committed to this treatment. It is widely known that fertility treatment, the investigations, the multiple rounds to the hospital can be terribly stressful for the couple. And today, most fertility units have on-site counselors available to offer you support through the treatment. It is therefore up to every couple or every person to make a counseling appointment whenever they feel they need to speak to somebody. Now, this is a very confidential service, and even the counselor will speak to somebody about your treatment only if the situation so demands. So thank you very much for your patient hearing. If there are any queries, I'm more than happy to take your questions now. there is a lot more to ART, like egg freezing, sperm freezing for cancer, so on and so forth. But unfortunately, time does not permit me to delve deeper into all of this. The sole purpose of my talk today was to just clarify doubts pertaining to two common procedures, that is IUI and IVF. Thankfully, this presentation is on YouTube for people to see and gain information. So let's start taking questions. The first question is, in case of a male partner, okay. So we can get sperm. If a man cannot ejaculate sperm, today we have the option of getting sperm directly from the testes through testicular sperm aspiration, through percutaneous epididymal sperm aspiration, or TESA sperm extraction. And this sperm can be used successfully in injecting the eggs, and we can have embryos and we can have babies through testicular sperm. So yes, there is every option available for male factor infertility where a man cannot ejaculate sperm. Okay. There is a question asking me what are the effects of emerging contaminants in fertility. I'm not very sure what you mean. If you could elaborate, I will try and answer your question. I have answered that question already. How do we pick and choose embryos? As I said, the embryo selection is done in the lab, and today we are delving into procedures such as metabolomics, where an embryo metabolism is looked at, and we pick and choose the right embryo for transfer based on the absorption of the minerals and essential chemicals by the embryo in the culture dish. Apart from that, there are procedures such as pre-implantation genetic screening of embryos that is also used to segregate embryos that have normal complement of chromosomes and those that are abnormal or have an aneuploidy. And but my recent attendance at the meeting in ESHRE, the European Society of Human Reproduction, there was a strong call to avoid doing pre-implantation genetic screening of embryos for aneuploidy, because it is possible that we may be discarding some very healthy embryos. So I think this is best discussed with your clinician and the fertility center where you are availing of therapy. That's answered. Okay, somebody's asked me a question. How many times can someone avail of IVF treatment? The most important thing that people need to remember is do not make fertility treatment the be-all and end-all of your life. It is important to have a child, to complete your family, to experience motherhood, but it is not necessary that everybody will achieve a pregnancy. Roughly at the end of three full IVF cycles, we would expect 65 to 70% of the couples to achieve a pregnancy. There will still be those that have not achieved a pregnancy despite IVF treatment. And then there are other options that the couple can follow. They can either go down the route of adoption, or they may want to consider donor eggs if their egg quality is poor, or something else, depending on what their comorbidities are. So I would say that if you've been through three IVF cycles, you need to call it a day, unless you have the mental capacity and the financial capacity to carry on with treatment. And hand on heart, I have had a few patients that have persevered and they have been successful through assisted conception way beyond the 3 attempts. And I'm glad they persevered because today they have their own baby, because many couples are averse to taking gametes from others, donor gametes, or they cannot digest the thought of adoption. But these are all valid options available to you. And it is extremely important that you do not make your fertility journey the be-all and end-all of your life. There is more to life, and being a mother does not define you as a woman. So this is something I would want to say to all women out there. So environmental factors do affect, and there are, so what we do is, there is oxidative stress that we experience through environmental factors, and there are tablets and medications that we use to reduce the impact of the oxidative stress in women before they embark on the treatment. It is important to do yoga. It is important to take the essential vitamins and minerals. So vitamin C supplements, a healthy diet, you know, which is complete in terms of fruits, salads, green leafy vegetables, lentils, and what have you. So a complete healthy diet, adequate water intake, regular exercise, antioxidants, all of these put together can most certainly improve egg quality. Quitting nicotine, smoking, avoiding alcohol, all these also go an extra mile in making the egg and the sperm parameters better. So I hope I have answered that question as well for you. Somebody has asked if we can talk about mental health issues associated with IVF. Yes, I would be more than happy to take up the topic next time. But for now, it's time to say goodbye. And I want to thank you all for your patient hearing. And it's been wonderful to talk to all of you and answer at least some of your questions. We are at Fortis Bangalore, so you are more than welcome to email us your queries should you wish. And goodbye. Have a good evening. And thank you very much. Namaskar.